See, to live is to suffer. And to survive, well, that's to find meaning in the suffering.
Hey, yo, I'm slipping, I'm falling, I can't get up. Hey, yo, I'm slipping, I'm falling, I can't get up. Hey, yo, I'm slipping, I'm falling, I got to get up. Get back on my feet so I can tear stick. Hey, yo, I'm slipping, I'm falling, I can't get up. Hey, yo, I'm slipping, I'm falling, I can't get up. Hey, yo, I'm slipping, I'm falling, I got to get up. Get back on my feet so I can tear stick.
Okay, Mr. Ordinary, so I'm just going to ask you a few questions so we can make some general assessments and get you the help you need. Sound good?
Yeah.
Mr. Ordinary, do you know why you're here?
Yeah.
And why is that?
I tried to kill myself.
Okay. Was this the first time you'd ever made a suicidal gesture of any sort?
A what?
A suicidal gesture. We use the term gesture to differentiate between those who seemingly intend or attempt to kill themselves versus those who maybe make an impulsive decision to not be alive. So was it...
Was it what?
The first time you...
No. I tried to kill myself when I was 14 and then I think again around 19.
Remind me again, how old are you?
I'm 33. Huh. Just like Farley and Belushi.
What?
Chris Farley and John Belushi, they were both 33 when they... Never mind.
Okay, let's see. Have you ever experienced a distinct period of abnormally and persistently elevated mood or energy?
Yes.
Following a period like this, have you ever experienced a prolonged or deep sense of sadness, despair, emptiness, or hopelessness, distinguishable by a diminished interest or pleasure in all or almost all activities, most of the day, nearly every day, causing fatigue and irritability, which then brings about feelings of worthlessness or excessive or inappropriate guilt, leading to a weakening of your ability to think or concentrate, resulting in indecisiveness or recurring thoughts, dwelling around death or suicidal intention?
Yes.
How much sleep do you get in a night on average?
I don't know, 3, maybe 4 hours.
Okay. Have any of your close friends or family ever remarked that you were more talkative than usual or that you're suddenly speaking faster than usual?
Yeah, I talk fast, yeah.
But have people around you ever indicated that you are more talkative or speaking faster than usual?
I talk sort of fast, so no, I guess.
Have you ever spent money irresponsibly?
Yes, all the time. Who doesn't?
Do you now, or have you ever had a tendency to become violent?
No.
No.
I mean, not unjustifiably so.
Hey. Can you give me an example of justifiable violence?
I don't know, like self-defense?
No, I mean a specific example of when you felt you used violence justifiably.
Well, when I was a freshman in college, I was attacked by some skinheads because I was dating a black girl.
And you defended yourself?
No. this is incredible. They knocked me down a flight of steps and then kicked me into a 3-day coma.
Wow.
Yeah, I bumped into a few of them at a gas station near campus a couple months later. They didn't even recognize me.
What happened?
I said something insulting to one of them, you know, to intentionally piss him off. Apparently it worked. When he came over to me, he got all over my face, took the gas nozzle out of my car, cracked him in the head with it. And put him out cold. Gas went all over the place, all over both of us. His buddy saw it happen. I remember one of them started to get out of the car, and you know, the door was left open, so as he started to climb out of the back seat, I jumped over there before he could, and I slammed the door in his arm like 3 or 4 times. I don't remember what happened after that, but then the guy that worked at the gas station, Indian guy, Indian, not native, anyway, he sort of shook me and said, hey buddy, you've got to get out of here, the cops are on the way, you've got to go. I looked around as I went to get back in my car, and I saw the third guy all sort of hunched over, kind of writhing on the ground. there was blood all over the place. So yeah, I think that was justifiable.
Would you say you have a high opinion of yourself, or are you maybe overly confident?
No, I'd say I'm the appropriate amount confident.
Do you now have, or have you ever had delusions of grandeur? Like, do you think that you're destined for great things? For example, to become famous or rich or something like that?
Well, I've been an actor my whole life. I mean, I worked hard to become good at what I do, and I always believed I'd be successful. Was I trying to become famous? I guess. I did a bunch of TV commercials and I made it to Broadway, so
wow,
I...
Wow, really? Would I have seen you in something?
No, I was...
My wife and I, we go to Broadway shows all the time. What were you in?
It was called the... You know, man, I was just an understudy mostly, so...
Sounds exciting.
Yeah.
Well, what do you do now?
I'm a teacher.
Oh, so you gave up acting.
I'm a drama teacher.
Right, because there must not be any professional acting to do right here in Rochester.
No, right. I'm a member of the Actors Union, so I can't really do non-union work.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's see. Have you ever had sexual relations with more than one partner in a calendar year? Okay, have you ever had sexual relations with more than one partner in a 6-month period?
Yes, sir.
Have you ever had sex with more than one person in a 3-month period?
Yep.
A month?
Listen, doctor, could you skip?
2 weeks, week, day.
Hey, look, I've had a number of group sex experiences.
How many is a number?
I don't know, 10-ish?
So, multiple partners at the same time.
Yeah, right. Are you saying that all these things are symptoms, like indicators that there's something wrong with me, like it's not normal?
Well, it's not that it's not normal, it's just not that ordinary.
I mean, come on, man, wouldn't you love to be in a three-way with two beautiful women? Isn't that every man's dream?
This isn't about me. But for what it's worth, I think that some things are better left to fancy, to remain only in our minds. Okay, well, in light of recent events and with the information that you've given me here, I feel confident that we can safely diagnose you as having bipolar 1 disorder.
I thought my therapist said I had personality disorder not otherwise specified.
Well, that was before your recent suicidal gesture. At this point, I'm going to recommend committing you for a brief period to our psych ward here in the hospital for further evaluation. Get you on some medication that will balance your emotions and to begin an aggressive psychotherapy plan to aid in your recovery.
Wait. Committed? But I have to go back to work. I have...
Well, it's not safe for you to be working right now.
But is there anything else we can do? I mean, I don't really...
Well, if you'd agree to it, you really don't think you're a harm to yourself or others around.
No.
Well, I could recommend that you partake in a partial hospitalization program. This is where you show up to the hospital every day for 8 hours and undergo personal evaluations through one-on-one sessions and in a group therapy setting. During that time, the doctors will attempt to find an effective medication arrangement for you as well. Well, it's almost identical to the program here in the hospital, but you get to go home.
Yeah. Okay, that sounds great.
All right. Well, I'm not completely comfortable with making this recommendation, but you'll have to sign an agreement with the hospital that states that you'll see the program through to the end. And it's important to you for you to know that at any time that the therapists or the doctors should recommend that you be placed in a more rehabilitative full-time care situation. You understand?
I understand. I am bipolar. In the disability movement, self-identification with your illness is an unpopular point of view. Generally, there are efforts made to distance folks from their disabilities by saying X has cerebral palsy or Y lives with schizophrenia as opposed to Z is manic depressive. I don't know, I just refuse to let language protect people from the realities of my existence. Saying I suffer from or I'm diagnosed with or simply have bipolar disorder feels like a cop-out. Would you like to have some of this cherry pie? Sounds like an option. Being bipolar is not an option. I can't just walk it off or get over it. There's no cure. Yet. And even if I could be cured, I'm not sure that I'd want to exactly. If my brain didn't function in this precise way, I wouldn't have gone about the world in the manner in which I had. I would not be who I am. So I think who I am is a direct result of this disorder. I am bipolar. I'd rather own up to that than be considered a poor diseased victim by anyone. Maybe that's the mania talking. Who's to say?
Being confident, capable, expressive, articulate, thoughtful, intelligent, gregarious, witty, generous, very creative, with lots of new ideas, and able to maintain a high energy level with little sleep. Work hard. Read special significance into things, take risks, react honestly and quickly, make keen observations, feel at one with nature, carefree, generate vividly imaginative scenarios, find humor in unusual places, sing without provocation or reason. To some, these might seem valuable, if not envied traits. But to someone who's bipolar, these are warning signs of mania. A manic episode is a distinct period of time where those symptoms are present.
The reason those traits are more of a problem is that on the other side of the mania coin is depression, severe depression. The rapid swing from one of those moods to another is what defines being bipolar, and the understandable inability to handle that swing is what makes it a disease, thus hazardous to your health.
The other pole. If I can sense a bout of depression on the horizon, I'm supposed to openly talk about it with a close friend, family member, or optimally my therapist. Depression is considered the more dangerous of the two poles because a depressed person is seemingly more susceptible to extremely negative thoughts, which could put them in danger of self-inflicting physical harm. In opposition to that, when you're manic, you usually feel way too good to consider hurting yourself. Unless you count the distinct sense of sincere invincibility, which also creates a high potential for actions which could have self-inflicted painful consequences.
If in the throes of a rapid cycle, a time when mood swings drastically, within a matter of a week, a day, or even just a few hours, we are encouraged to just lie down, close our eyes, curl up, and wait for it to pass. This treatment is reminiscent of the U.S. government-developed method of duck. When protecting oneself from the effects of an atomic bomb, to remain safe, we have to try to remove ourselves from any social situation like work, family gatherings, and casual discussions with friends, and then quickly get to a safe place where we can be monitored. Not too closely, though, because that could also cause adverse effects. If all else fails, go to the fallback recommendation of immediate hospitalization.
All of this type of information is downloaded into you the moment you're diagnosed in an attempt to help you both self-identify and promptly manage any symptoms you may be exhibiting before they get out of your control. Unfortunately, this information mostly leads to confusion when you realize now you have to be suspicious of every reaction and mood you experience. We can never be too sure if the emotions we are feeling are appropriate or not, so the default position must be one of healthy fear. Just in case.
In order to live a somewhat emotionally and mentally balanced life, they, the therapeutic medical community, tell us to attempt mindfulness. But it's hard to be mindful when your mental illness prevents you from trusting what your mind is communicating to you. Besides, what does that even mean? Let's find out!
Mindfulness is the state of being mindful, which is then defined as conscious.
Which, of course, is not the same, as we all know, as being not asleep.
So, while even the Buddha may have noticed the importance of mindfulness by making it one of the seven sadhamas, requisites of enlightenment, I don't think he meant that we only had to be physically awake to achieve that goal. Being mindful is a useful skill for anybody, but if you're bipolar, it can literally mean the difference between life and death. During my time at partial hospitalization, I was taught a number of exercises to encourage mindfulness, slow breathing, color pattern visualizations, and other such meditative exercises are suggested to calm the mind. I thought this was going to be a breeze because as an undergrad theater major, I was taught similar methods to find neutral so that I may shed my own idiosyncrasies and more fully realize the persona of the character I am portraying. I also learned how to focus my breathing in a way that readies my voice for a powerful performance. We even ventured into introductory yoga to discover our centers. Incidentally, my acting two professor never explained what we were supposed to do once we found our center. All of these seemingly creative devices are used for theater artists to more deeply understand the world in order to hold as twere the mirror up to nature, to show virtue her feature, scorn her own image. While inherently harmless, many of these methods are taken as fads, and even at their best, they're always in service of the art, while the artist is left to languish. Throughout my treatment, I've undergone aggressive therapy as well as being guided on a seemingly endless search of the most effective medicinal combinations. All of this stuff is for what's known as mental health maintenance, but it didn't seem to be addressing anything deeper, as spiritual, I guess. Now, I'm admittedly and patently no longer a religious person, and to be polite here, I'm simply not interested in becoming one ever again. Ever. But for me, mindfulness is about awareness, and my attempt to achieve it has included some holistic and otherwise alternative recommendations for treatment, such as natural light, vitamin supplements, and the sometimes somewhat spiritual practice of meditation. With meditation, I'm not judging my thoughts or even really thinking for that matter, but I am aware, mindful, conscious, awake, not asleep. Aware of my place, not just in the room, but in the world. Maybe even the universe. I feel like the freedom to sit quietly and just be is invaluable. Good fucking luck with that, right? So I did a little research and decided to build my own personal meditation altar, a private place of reflection, a sanctuary where I can create my own rituals, surrounded by my personal effects. I don't know, I already had a man cave strewn with Star Wars and comic book nerd paraphernalia, but that's where I go to sometimes at late at night to watch dumb TV shows and unplug. Now I wanted to plug in. So I sat a moment and opened myself up to the thoughts of the kinds of objects I wanted to place on my altar. My stuff. The little things with great meaning that have somehow managed to move with me from place to place for years and years. But tonight I'll be showing telling you about some of those that initially made it onto my altar. I say initially because, as I understand it, while items on the surface of your altar are added, like so many things in our lives, they have their time and then are replaced or just fade away. My mom gave this watch to my father on their wedding day. Engraved on the front are his initials, L.M. Inside the inscription, "Forever yours, Joanne." My father left me and my mother when I was two. They were legally divorced a year or so later. He must have left it behind after because it lived in my mom's dresser drawer until she gave it to me as part of my high school graduation gift. My father's up to life number three. My mom never remarried. She seems to have stayed true to that promise she etched in 24 karat gold, plating almost 4 years ago. She'll be my mom forever, so I guess there's another promise she'll never break. When I was about five, my mother's parents came to pick me up, and they wanted to take me to a movie. And they asked me what I wanted to go see. I didn't have really any idea. So they were like, okay, cool, we'll go see Jaws. Seems like and for those of you that are like, that's not matching up for you, it was a re-release. It had huge success in the 70s, and they were just like, yeah, let's put it back in theaters and have people go send their families to see it again. So while we were getting ready to go, my grandparents showed up. My father called. He called our house and wanted to talk to me, but we were getting ready to leave. And so my father, Jaws. He's like, are you out of your fucking mind? This is one of the most violent movies that's been released in the past 20 years. People leave the place vomiting, terrified. You're gonna send a five-year-old to this place? You don't have the fucking brains you were born with. What are you, stupid? That's my son! She didn't know what to say. We were already gone. was on the phone for a minute and then realized, oh, wait a minute, well, this can't be that bad. And he said, Joanne, at the end of the fucking movie, this shark bites this guy in half, pulls part of his body out of the water while he screams in pain and agony. Do you understand what you've done? And she said, wait a minute, you said it's at the end of the movie? He'll fall asleep. He doesn't see the end of movies. He hasn't seen the end of a movie his whole life. So they hung up the phone and he said, call me the minute he walks in the house with your parents. What they both didn't really account for is my grandparents had a tendency to show up early to places. Whatever it was, if you had them coming over for dinner or something like that, they'd always show up as you were cleaning up. You know, like last minute you're trying to do the dishes and ding dong, there they were, making my mom feel like shit, sort of, you know? So back in the day, movies did used to, they ran back to back, you know, just right back to back. So I actually saw the last 37 minutes of Jaws first. With no context at all. I had zero idea what was going on. So I did, but I fell asleep, you know, before the end of the next one. And so when I got home, my father, like he said, like Clapper, he was on the phone with him again. He said, as soon as he walks in the house, you put him on the phone with me. So I walk in, my grandparents say goodnight, and my mother says, hey, father wants to talk to you. And he goes, hey, how are you doing? Are you okay? Well, how are you feeling? Just talk to me. Talk to your father. Talk to dad. Tell me everything that's on your mind. I said, Dad, you haven't seen this movie. This shark bit the dude in half, and he ripped him apart, and he dragged him into the water, and there were like blood and guts all over the place. And that boat didn't even sink. It didn't make any sense. I don't know how the boat stayed up. And then the shark stayed around, and the other guy ended up killing him. But you didn't know the one dude was alive. He popped up in the air. It was awesome. My mother just grabbed the phone out of my hand. She said, scarred for life, huh? I looked at my mom after she hung up the phone and said, Mom, when I grow up, I want to be a shark. She said, well, sweetie, you're a human, and you can't grow up to be an animal. But I love that movie, and I want to be in that movie. She said, there you go, hon. All the people in that movie are called actors. Actors can be anybody, anything. Even sharks? Yeah, I guess. She said an actor could play a shark. Okay. I'll be one of them.
Well, Mr. Ordinary, at this point we have a few options. With the support of your current medicine, you seem to have the bipolar depression under control.
Yeah.
What we need to do now is try to stabilize you so as to put off any manic episodes. Does that sound like something that interests you?
Yeah, that sounds good.
Well, the best course of action to take at this point would be to add lithium as part of your treatment. Okay? You look concerned. Do you have any questions?
Well, I heard it's an intense drug.
I suppose intense in how effective it is, but quite on the contrary, the drug itself has no real intensity.
Can you tell me more about it?
Sure. Lithium acts on a person's central nervous system, your brain and your spinal cord. We don't really know exactly how lithium works to stabilize a person's mood, but it is thought to help strengthen nerve cell connections in brain regions that are involved in regulating mood, thinking, and behavior. Usually it takes several weeks for lithium to begin working, but it is known to significantly reduce the risk of bipolar-related suicide and the severity and frequency of the mania, perhaps preventing future manic and depressive episodes altogether.
What's it like being on it?
Well, of course, there are possible side effects of lithium, like increased thirst, increased urination, diarrhea, vomiting, weight gain, impaired memory, poor concentration, drowsiness, muscle weakness, hair loss, acne, unsteady walking, fainting, confusion, slurred speech, or rapid heart rate, and hand tremors, which, if the tremors become particularly bothersome, I can prescribe additional medication to help. Okay?
No, not just the side effects. What's the effect of the drug on your life?
Well, it is an ultimate mood stabilizer. So, when things are sad, for instance, you will recognize them as such, but you will most likely not cry or find yourself overcome with emotion, and vice versa. If something is joyous or funny, you will know it as that is the case, but you will not really be able to outwardly express that joy or laugh, which is essentially an emotional reaction. You will be stable.
Doctor, that sounds horrible. I'm a performing artist, and that's what I do. I access and relate emotion. Performing and teaching performance is how I make a living.
So maybe just do more teaching and less performing. You will be able to remember those feelings, thus remaining able to teach others how to portray those emotions, while you yourself will be safe from the depression and mania, the emotional roller coaster associated with bipolar 1 disorder.
No. This doesn't sound good. Or safe. Shouldn't I be able to access my own emotions?
What good has that done you until now?
Listen.
What you need to realize is that you have to make the choice between a balanced, healthy mind and the quality of your life.
Wait, I thought I was working on balancing my emotions so that the quality of my life would be better.
Oh, no. In order to achieve balance, to be mentally sound, it is very likely the quality of your life as you now know it will diminish greatly. But you'll be safe. You'll be alive.
Mr. Ordinary is a 34-year-old, right-handed, married Caucasian male with long-standing but recently diagnosed bipolar 1 disorder and a personality disorder as well. He was born in a naval hospital in Portsmouth, Virginia, and raised in Brooklyn, New York by his parents until age 2 when they divorced. He remained with his mother, who is a retired social service worker living in central New York. His father remarried when Mr. Ordinary was 7, divorced his second wife 9 years ago, and married a third time approximately 7 years ago. He has 2 younger paternal half-siblings from his father's second marriage, 11 and 15 years younger than himself. He stated that his father, too, suffers from bipolar disorder and is still prone to extreme mania and violence, while his mother is obese and depressed. Mr. Ordinary resides with his wife and has a driver's license and a vehicle. Psychiatric history is positive for suicide attempt by overdose that resulted in admission to the County Behavioral Health Partial Hospitalization Program following an initial evaluation with doctor intake at the Adult Ambulatory Clinic Psyche Emergency Department. Mr. Ordinary had already begun outpatient treatment in May 2009 and used medicine prescribed by Dr. Lithium for the overdose. He has made a prior suicide attempt at age 14 by slitting his wrist, and he noted that both attempts had followed upsetting phone calls with his father. Mr. Ordinary has a long-standing history of mood instability dating back to childhood, and he has used his energy swings to assist in his creative endeavors. He feels his manic episodes were tied to his career status, and he crashed when a job was finished. He believes his symptoms were latent but present and fit well with my career. In other words, he had a pre-existing bipolar disorder that was channeled adequately until recently. The presence of his condition may have been more easily identified once he was placed in a work situation that required evenness and consistency, not allowing for manic swings of energy to which he had become accustomed as an entertainment industry professional. Increasing difficulty coping with the demands of his new position as a school teacher manifested in the form of an acute depressive episode. Manic or depressive episodes have lasted anywhere from a few hours to 6 months and have not been accompanied by hallucinations, delusions, or other psychotic symptoms. Mania is characterized by impulsivity, rapid decision-making, a disregard for consequences, insomnia, restlessness, agitation, and panic attacks, while depression generally entails low mood, irritability, increased appetite, hypersomnia, guilt, and lethargy.
March 1984, 8 years old.
School assignment. Write a letter to one of the people in the stories featured in the current events.
To whom I may concern, last week I read a news story that Ringling Brothers Circus turned a goat into a unicorn. I think that's one of the meanest things you could do to a goat. Now his family won't recognize him and other goats will think he's weird. You're not nice to do this to him. How would you like it if I took your nose, put it in the middle of your forehead so people would pay money to look at you and laugh at you? You wouldn't like it, so put the goat back to a goat. Thank you.
Teacher's note. Very good work. Please have your mother set up a parent-teacher conference.
Mr. Ordinary arrived early for his evaluation, having driven himself. He is 6 foot, 240 pounds, with short brown hair, hazel eyes, mustache, beard, and casual attire. Eye contact was well maintained, and he was oriented in all spheres. Gait was within normal limits, despite occasional backbreak. Demeanor was alert, cooperative, and motivated. Speech was very fluid and spontaneous. Thought processes were logical, organized, and free of psychosis. Mr. Ordinary's manner of relating was candid and responsive. His approach to the evaluation process was positive. He was able to build a good rapport with this examiner. Mood was euthymic, and affect was full range and appropriate to content. Insight is good, and judgment is presently intact. Substance abuse history is positive for prior marijuana use because it helps me sleep. Mr. Ordinary said he drinks wine socially, having consumed stronger alcohol more frequently during 10th and 11th grades,
before school, during the school day, after school, and on weekends and holidays.
He does not now, nor has he ever abused caffeine or tobacco. There were no elevations in scores on the scales measuring anxiety, somatization, mania, dysthymia, alcohol or drug dependence, trauma, major depression, hallucinations, delusions, paranoia, or any form of psychosis. He responded with an average level of self-disclosure and demonstrated average concern with others' opinions. His personality structure is such that he has a tendency towards self-focus and confidence. He may believe that things will work out well and that others will recognize in him special attributes. Negative feedback may be externalized, and he may fail to take personal responsibility for outcomes, and he often engages in self-defeating thought patterns and behavior choices. He tends to experience his emotions strongly, regardless of whether this is manifested outwardly or not, and he requires attention and approval in order to feel emotionally secure. Because he has a clear plan and goal, the vocational preference inventory was not required.
April 1986, 10 years old.
School assignment. Write about something you hate and something you love.
I hate President Reagan. My mom said you should not say you hate someone because that means you wish death upon them. I don't think it was right to bomb Libya. Muammar Gaddafi is a bad guy, but innocent women and children died when bombs hit their houses. President Reagan did this, and I hate him for it. I love my grandpa Sal. He takes me and my cousins, Michael and Matthew, to the movies, buys us pizza, and takes out his teeth to scare us.
Teacher's note. Follow directions more carefully. The assignment was to write about something you hate and love, not someone. Please have your mother set up a parent-teacher conference.
Based on the symptoms and signs, he appears to meet the criteria for primary bipolar 1 disorder, characterized by one or more full-blown manic episodes alternating with depressive episodes. Some of the events and details he provided suggest that his difficulties were more severe than those typical of mild or hypomania, which characterizes bipolar 2 disorder. Psychological assessment indicated that he is not experiencing any severe acute distress at this time, likely reflecting the stabilizing efficacy of his comprehensive treatment protocol consisting of psychotherapy and psychotropic medication. Mr. Ordinary's achievement scores indicate great proficiency in basic reading, word attack, and recognition, reading comprehension and spelling, written encoding and written decoding skills were at the advanced level. Mathematical calculations are at the 11th grade level. This is most likely due to long-standing minor weakness in this area and the degradation of recall for complex processes over time that he originally learned them and has relatively no use for them now. Cognitive ability testing reveals he is functioning in the superior range of intellectual potential with absolutely no weaknesses detected. Verbal comprehension and language processing are very superior. There is a personality pattern evident that is histrionic and narcissistic in nature, and is also comprised of self-defeating thoughts and behavioral patterns. There are no cognitive or intellectual barriers to his educational or vocational success, though in the unlikely event he is required to take advanced mathematics courses, the calculator may prove helpful.
January 1991, 14 years old. Dear Ms. Buchanan, I'm writing you this letter in response to your recommending me for a week of in-school suspension. I don't understand. I explained that I only refused to stand up and say the Pledge of Allegiance while we're at war. I didn't know that was against school policy. So I apologized. But you still sent me off to Mr. Hyler's office. He said the rule was as long as I stood up, I don't have to say the actual pledge. You didn't even give me that as an option. You just sent me off to the principal's office like some criminal. I thought you were one of the only people that understood me. And I know we're not peers, and I do respect you as my teacher, but you know, when you helped me with my audition for Our Town, I felt like we connected. Every time you ask the class for someone to read Julius Caesar and no one volunteers, who always does? Me. When you told me you were curious about rap music, I lent you my only copy of License to Ill, even though it's my favorite tape, which, by the way, you have yet to return me. And when you gave me that copy of Leaves of Grass right before Christmas, I don't know, I just felt like we were cool. But I can see we're not cool. You are not cool. Is this because your last name is Buchanan? Are you like related to President James Doughface Buchanan or something? And you're pissed about it, so now you're taking it out on me? So in conclusion, Ms. Buchanan, I don't want to be suspended, therefore I will stand up, but I won't say the pledge until the war is over. And in the words of Walt Whitman, I will make a song for the ears of the president, full of weapons with menacing points, and behind the weapons, countless dissatisfied faces. Well, Ms. Buchanan, you're going to have to see my dissatisfied face for 3.5 more years. Thank you. P.S. Seriously, I want my Beastie Boys tape back.
Mr. Ordinary has a mood disorder that will likely require some form of ongoing care if he is to achieve and maintain optimal stabilization. He is well advised to continue with his current treatment regimen through County Behavioral Health Services, consisting of individual psychotherapy and psychotropic medication monitoring. Although perhaps unfamiliar and even undesirable to him, he may do best with structure and adherence to a routine that will help offset rather than potentiate mood swings from neurochemical or biorhythmic dysregulation. That said, he does require considerable mental and emotional stimulation in order to feel filled, the lack of which could have self-destructive results. From Britannia to Egypt, Spain to Parthia, the Roman Empire is more glorious than it has ever been. The magnificence of our citizens strengthened by the might of our military. Now is the time to join the ranks and become the legionnaire you were always born to be. Are you a male between the ages of 16 and 46? Well then, chances are you are about to be drafted anyway. So what? Say we take a second look and learn what it's like to be one of these great men as we discover a day in the life of a Roman soldier. Meet Optio. He has been personally selected by a centurion to take over command in battle, should the need arise, supervise subordinates, as well as perform a variety of administration duties. His pay is double the standard legionary pay, and he is the most likely to be promoted after the retirement, promotion, or death of a centurion. The day of every Roman soldier begins at sunrise. After you and your 7 tent mates clean up, it's time for your first meal of the day, which is made of grain, mainly wheat, barley, and oats, but also spelt and rye. If you choose, you can make bread, but the fastest way to get this hearty meal in your system is to make it into a simple yet delectable drink. Just a dash of river water and yum, just like Mom used to make. Now that you've carbo-loaded with 100% whole grains, it's time to break up camp and hit the road. Marching is just one of the many daily fun and exciting pastimes of a Roman soldier. Just 20 miles each and every day with over 80 pounds of armor, weaponry, and gear, and you'll not only start to get in great shape, but you'll be seeing some of the most beautiful landscapes on this flat planet. Time to take a break? No, not yet. Now you get the training you've been waiting for. Before it gets too hot, You'll learn the many battle styles and formations that have helped make us the most powerful empire in the world. Light the way. Legionnaires, form up a triad. Now, one man, get up in front to form a tip and point yourself directly toward the enemy.
What?
Or you may prefer the testudo, or tortoise. Essentially a defensive formation by which the legionnaires hold their shields overhead, except for the front rows. You hold yours out front. There. Now you've created a shell-like kind of armor, shielding you and your brothers against attack from or above. What's next, you ask? Well, these world-renowned roads, walls, bridges, camps, and fortifications aren't going to build themselves. So grab a shovel, start digging, and we'll see you at noon, soldier.
Some of the bloodiest battles in history of the slow birth of the Roman Empire took place in the region of Gaul known as Araugio. Ancient Gaul spread roughly through what is today Belgium and France, and the small area of Araugio has become the village of Orange, a word that is so much more pleasing to the ear en français than in American English. The first of these battles was in 105 BCE, when a force of 200,000 tribesmen of Gaul, thought to be of German and Celtic descent, defended their land, decimating the forces of the Roman Republic and killing all but a few of the 120,000 Romans in attendance. In true Roman fashion, this defeat would create a grudge they carry for generations to come. And during the Gallic Wars, which spread from 58 to 51 BCE, the Roman Republic, with a force of 120,000 legionnaires and auxiliaries, and under the command of a young ambitious general named Gaius Julius Caesar, would kill and or capture approximately 1 million Gallic warriors and common citizens. Those lucky enough to be captured alive would be enslaved by the Romans and then scattered all across the Republic. Officially founded in 40 BCE, the Julian colony of Araugio, roots of the pleasant sound of the French word orange, was established by the soldiers of the 2nd Legion. Former residents of Gaul were now, like the Greeks and Etruscans before them, living in Rome. As they were not of Roman descent, were forced into back-breaking work to ensure and instill the glory of Rome. As a testament to the hard-fought victory, two amazing structures would, over time, be miraculously erected in this infamous and historically rich village. First, the triumphal Arc of Orange, or Arc de Triomphe d'Orange, which stands at the village's entrance, adorned with stone carvings depicting various battle scenes, touting the superiority of the Roman forces that besieged the armies of Gaul. A predecessor, and no doubt inspiration to the much larger Arc de Triomphe d'Etoile in Paris, which honors those who fought in the French Revolution. The Arc in Orange is considered by many to be even more remarkable, as it is the oldest surviving example of a structure of its kind. It is, however, only second to the most impressive of two major monuments and examples of Roman architecture in Orange today. Built in the first century Common Era, at the behest of Caesar Augustus, first emperor of the Roman Empire, the Théâtre Antique d'Orange is described as one of the best preserved of all Roman theaters, and the most impressive still existing in Europe today. It stood as a symbol of the strength of the empire, but more importantly, was used by Caesar as means of disseminating the culture of Rome to its outer colonies. In addition to gifting the citizens a variety of free, enjoyable theatrical entertainments, theaters like this were used as tools to distract the common people from being interested in the political goings-on of the empire. The theater itself, an outdoor amphitheater which seats over 10,000 people, features a 10-story stage wall and a 426.5-foot-long deck, or stage platform. The Romans did everything big. But with an enslaved workforce, even the majesty of the theater antique seems a bit less impressive.
Yeah, to me the work of those enslaved was very personal. In 2002, my best friend Mark and I set upon an adventure through parts of Europe that would change my life for the better and forever. The trip was part of a summer graduate study program at the University of Georgia. Mark was attending UGA and had stumbled upon this cinema directions production study abroad program. He knew it was a dream of mine to travel to Italy. Most of my family moved to America in the late 1920s. I had always hoped to visit there someday, but I never really thought that day would come. You said on your stoop, broken Brooklyn for the early part of your life, you tend to think that's about as far as you're actually gonna go. So when he sent me the details, it just seemed unlikely. In order to pull this off, I grabbed a good paying job, laying tile in the homes of the unnecessarily rich out in the Hamptons on Long Island. I sent him every penny I made, the instant I made it, to prearrange our trip, knowing full well if I didn't get the cash out of my hands immediately, it'd be gone. A year and a half before that, a group of college mates and I realized another dream. This dream wasn't one I'd been harboring since I was a child. It was one that was implanted in me during my time as an undergrad. And it was to own and operate our own theater. Our acting professor and mentor during my time at SUNY Fredonia had consistently stressed the importance of doing our own work, not of being under the thumb of any industry and never leaving well enough alone. We listened, we understood, and we agreed. Just 1 year after my graduation, my dad gave me $9,000. It was part of a loan he took from his pension as a New York City firefighter. We took that money and turned it into nearly $250,000 in cash and contractual bartering. Building and operating a theater would take an immense and intense group effort. Part of the expense of the venture was renting a house in which the company members could communally dwell. Communal is an understatement. It was like living with the Muppets. At one point, this 5.5 bedroom, 1.5 bathroom house was home to 26 recently graduated actors, musicians, and theater technicians. People were sleeping in stairwells and the unfinished basement. Common living areas were carved out into individual rooms by hanging theater draperies. Since we had invited these fine folks to take part in the endeavor, rent and groceries were covered by the business. Our naivete was astounding. We started running out of money fast. In order to keep costs down, a small core group of 4 or 5 of us actors and my father did all the demolition and building. It was grueling. Most days would be around 16 hours or more of hard work, and since we could barely afford the rent as it was, we didn't dare turn on the air conditioning. It took us over 11 months to completely renovate what was a former men's department store, 19 years closed, into a 7,000 square foot, 122-seat experimental theater space. Our artistic plan involved incorporating multimedia elements in our theatrical productions. We were going to attempt to combine the field of television with the craft of theater, so rather than call it theater vision, we called it vision theater. We were very proud of our accomplishment, perhaps a little too much so. Reality soon set in when we realized that in order to maintain this business, we'd be solely responsible for programming and producing everything that hit the stage. This wasn't college. There were no departmental budget meetings to decide how much money sets and props would cost. There was no money. So we made do with some donations and a little slick dealing operations to get the job done. And all this came together, somewhat miraculously. We put on 2 plays a month, each of which ran for 2 weeks, plus a weekly weekend improv show to actually raise money and get people in the door. Theater audiences are hard to come by. One time we performed a 2-man Edward Albee play, The Sioux Story, for one person. It was the other guy's aunt. She was in tears by the end. Eventually, to cover costs, we rented the theater to a couple local bands. It was a lot of work and there was no pay. It didn't seem like we'd ever get ahead. We started to doubt our ability to maintain this for any long time. I personally was very burned out, and as one of the slick deals I mentioned, I had also taken the job of entertainment director, a position I invented, at the newly opened Atlantis Marine World, right down the street. One of the owners of that multi-million dollar operation was Long Island's most successful construction company tycoon. I agreed to work there for free, 1 year, in this famed sunken city aquarium if they would hire my friends as entertainment staff, and if they'd give us the last of the construction materials needed to open. So I was working 2 full-time jobs for free, awesome. But it was for the love, right? For the love of an art form that had been planted inside me during college, and I would do anything to see it succeed. It was slowly killing me. I was Dr. Frankenstein. My creation had become a powerful, dangerous burden. It was just then that my best friend Mark, remember him? Called and said, hey, wanna go to Europe and study cinema? Hell yes! All I had to do was find another job and raise nearly $5,004 I'd need to spend a few months traveling around Europe, which would of course include a trip to the motherland, Italy, at last. Our base of operations for that program were that we lived and attended class in Avignon, France, a medieval walled city in the south of France's Provence region. Avignon was once the seat of the Holy Roman Catholic Church and the home of the Pope. It is a breathtakingly beautiful little city. You can walk from one side to the other in less than half an hour, which includes stopping to buy a fresh baguette, a bottle or two or three of locally made wine, and some locally made cheese and olives too. After living there for about a week, we discovered a secret wine tasting cellar inside the former palace of the Pope. The palace was one of Avignon's most popular tourist attractions, so the fact that this basement bar was unbeknownst to most visitors made it one of the most special things we could drop in and do after class for a pre-dinner drink featuring some of the best wine the Côte de Rhône had to offer. This included, but was in no way limited to, the famous wines of the Chateau Neuf du Pape. Its primary grape being the Beau Grenache Noir, and secondarily the understated and perfectly balanced additions of the Mourvèdre and Syrah, which by French law must make up 15% of the blend. Maintenant c'est la perfection dans la bouche. I fell madly in love with Provence and hope one day to return. When we weren't in class for the full 2 hours a day, we had to be hunched over a G4 Mac to learn the new and exciting revolution of digital film editing. We hopped on a train and just went anywhere. One day, we stopped in the village of Orange, in the commune of Valcluse. I don't remember why. I don't think we knew it had really any touristy ingredients. If we had, we probably would have avoided it altogether. And we were trying to have a more unique travel experience, not just the one you could find in Rick Steves' Guide to Wherever the Fuck. First, we bumped into the triumphal arch of Orange. There is some power oozing off that thing. The carving, the artwork, the craftsmanship itself is remarkable. As I read the sign that explained its history, I was even more excited. I'm a bit of a Roman history nut, and I can trace my heritage, my birth surname, on my father's side, all the way back to ancient times. So upon discovering that this was the site of some of the battles I'd read about and become so enamored with as a kid, a spiritual energy began to fill me, and I felt very warm. Okay, so I had just shaved my head that morning because I was tired of trying to explain the kind of haircut I wanted with my limited language skills. So I just used the all-purpose French phrase of "prends le tube," take it all off. And it was 101 degrees in the shade, but that wasn't it. This place had seen things. It had been witness to a history in a way America had not. I was terrified and empowered all at the same time. I could feel my Roman blood coursing through my veins, and I just knew there was more to discover, but I had no idea how much. So, you strolled past cute homes and quaint storefronts on tight cobblestone streets, which were spotted with ancient brass seals of the Roman Empire, and others depicting Octavius, Caesar, Augustus, his right hand raised in victory. Then you turn a corner, and you come face to face with an unbelievable sight. A 10-story wall, obviously ancient, but in near perfect condition. I thought to myself, they call these ruins, they should fucking visit Red Hook, Brooklyn. This was the Théâtre Antique d'Orange, and as the little display of multilingual pamphlets explained, for a very nominal fee, you could rent a pair of multilingual headphones and walk around inside on a multilingual self-guided tour. So I skipped the headphones, paid my €3, and headed in. I'll never forget the sensation of coolness on my skin as I crossed under the initial threshold of the entrance. This was ancient stone overhead. The entranceway was thick and dark. It seemed as though sunlight had never seen its depths. I was compelled to put my hand on the wall as I walked, and that energy from the arc started again, first up my spine, then into my heart. In an instant, as I entered the actual open air of the amphitheater, that cool sensation was replaced by the burning of the sun, now directly over my freshly shorn head. I took a deep breath, and I held it. I looked right, and I could see the 10,000 seats, an area which had been preserved for over 1,800 years under a layer of sand, and discovered only in the 19th century. With no exhale, I drew in another, deeper breath. I looked left, and there it was, the stage. A place more holy to me than any cathedral or any fancy chair on which any pope sat. I stepped softly, my left hand running gently along the lip of this tremendous platform. My eyes half closed as I got to the center area. I spread my arms as wide as they could go, placed both my hands on the stage, hung my head, and left. It's not because this was some ancient place that actors had merrily flittered across, entertaining citizens of an empire long fallen, but because it was built by slaves, It was hard work, and they would never get to enjoy the fruits of their labor. Each stone, hundreds of pounds, and in this heat, my God. Grueling does not begin to explain what went into raising this stage, and if you're open to it, you can feel it in the air. Then a new feeling crept in. I could feel in my hands the calluses that had built from brick breaking with a sledgehammer, throttling black iron pipe as I hand-threaded it to use as railing, and lifting and holding steel truss in place so that we might hang lights for our audience. I could feel each twinge and ache from the months of uncompensated work that went into building our home, our church, our stage. I built a theater in which I was both Caesar and a slave, star of the stage, and the unknown soul who died to build it. The theater antique was thankfully light in attendance that day, and there was only a few school and tour groups and a smattering of tourists from around the world. They were, as one might be, walking around looking at the columns, pointing at sculptures, and photographing statues. It took a while for me to get my bearings. Finally, I opened my eyes and began to turn around. Unbeknownst to me, one of the other marvels of this place, scientific in nature, was that its design is that the acoustics are so perfect, even a stage whisper can be heard from the furthest attendee, hundreds of feet away in the highest seat. The place was silent. As I realized that most of these strangers had been privy to a very personal moment, I did what any actor would do in that situation. Took a bow. Not a deep one, a modest one, right hand out, chin down to the left. I did this to show my gratitude for their caring attention. Those who were not wearing the self-guided multilingual headsets gave me a light, kind round of applause. As I made my way through the rest of the theater, making limited eye contact with my adoring public, I found my buddy Mark. He looked at me and said in a masculine tone, "You okay?" To which I responded, "Yeah, why?" It turned out he had also seen and heard just what I went through from the furthest point away and had even taken some pictures. Knowing I needed it, he gave me a big hug and we continued down the dark hall. As we neared a turning point that would bring us back into the open air, I impulsively made the decision that we needed to take a part of this incredible place with us. I took out my keys, told Mark to be on the lookout for security, and tried chipping away a tiny morsel of rock from this ancient marvel of construction. Well, it turns out, if you chip away at a nearly 2,000-year-old building with a key, a fist-sized chunk might fall off. So I tossed it in my backpack. We got the hell out of there like we just committed an international crime, which we probably had. The rest of the trip around Europe, more of France, Amsterdam, Florence, and Rome were almost as magical. But really, so much happened on that trip that changed my perception about the world. And as cliche as it sounds, I really found myself, or the me I needed to find back then. While in Rome, I also chipped away a piece of the Colosseum for good measure. We then happened upon a street jewelry maker who we commissioned to fashion these rocks into some sort of necklace. His name was Ambrogino Esposito, whose name was literally translated into Little Immortal One Who Was Abandoned by His Parents. Beside his table was a handwritten sign that read Zoponano, Gioielli della Sicilia, Lame Dwarf, Jewelry of Sicily. First he took his hammer, and with the impressive strength of a man who had been using only his arms to carry around the full weight of his body's entire life, he brought it down upon the Colosseum stone. As he smashed it to bits of dust, he turned to us with a disgusted, twisted look on his face and said, "Non originale." Even with my inadequate Italian, I knew he meant we had been duped. The part of the Colosseum wall with which I had absconded was false. Some bit added during one of the many restorations. We then dug into our bag and pulled out the stone, taken from the theater antique in Orange. This had been traveling around with Europe with us for months now. He placed it down on his table, again lifted his hammer high, and dropped his arm as though to evoke the spirit of Jupiter, Roman god of thunder, and nothing. With a glint in his eye, knowing full well he was holding a piece of history that, by its very possession, could no doubt lead to an international incident. He beamed. Originale. For 2 days in 107-degree dry heat, he painstakingly fashioned two almost identical leather, steel, and stone necklaces. We wore them with pride in memory of the power of the Roman Empire, as a reminder of those it had enslaved, hoping that the theater itself could somehow right the wrongs of but by offering up the spirits of the characters who are lovingly created each night an actor steps foot and performs on that great stage. Not 2 years later, at a college reunion, my buddy Mark lost his.
Oh.
This maid's mine, now a one-of-a-kind treasure. And me, the sole possessor of the stolen stone of Alma.
Dites-moi d'où il vient, enfin je sais où je vais. Maman dit que lorsqu'on cherche bien, on finit toujours par trouver. Elle dit qu'il n'est jamais très loin.